Tony.
Is, I'm sorry?
What's that? Sorry, actually, Rick and I had a question as well, if that's okay.
That's fine.
When it comes to the Our Father prayer, why is it when we look at the King James Version, there's more verses in there that we don't actually say, such as, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors?
Yeah. The forgive us our debtors, and one of the things that we're going to beginning next week, Crystal, we're going to start going an introduction into the Bible. Okay. Not all Bibles are written or translated the same. Okay. So it's important that there's a difference between Catholic Bibles and the Protestant Bibles, which wordings have been altered from what they originally were, and books have been removed. And I'll explain all that beginning next week, because it's important that we know. Now, the debtors is what we call forgive us our sins as we forgive those who forgive our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. It's the wording that we use, but it's leading on the same path of when you call a debtor, is if you forgive those who owe you, you will be forgiven as well. Okay?
Yes, thank you.
Okay. Deacon Tony, sorry, I'm so sorry. One last question. Please. We know what happened to Mary. What happened to Joseph?
You know, so little is known of Joseph, because Joseph was very much like the RCIA class that I have in front of me, that they don't speak, and so we don't know. But Joseph was very, they call him a silent man, right? He didn't speak. We believed that he died before Jesus went on his ministry. The last time that scripture calls and writes about him is when they went to Jerusalem for the Passover, and then they were going home, and they had walked for 3 days, and then they realized that Jesus was missing, and they come back to Jerusalem, and then Mary refers to speaking to Jesus. We tells him, why have you done this to us? Didn't you realize that your father and I have been looking for you? And so that is the very last time that scripture refers to Joseph. So we believe that Joseph passed before Jesus began his ministry. At that time, Jesus, I think, was 12 years old, 12 or 13 years old at the temple. So that's the last time. We don't know much more about Joseph, and even in books that are not recognized, we have no writing on whatever happened to Joseph. Okay.
Thank you so much, Deacon.
No. I wish there was more to tell. I mean, he was a holy man, and of course, you know, one of the realities is that artists have always painted Joseph as an old man, right? And so it's easier for everyone to accept that, well, the old man died first. But that may not be absolutely true, because in those days, it could have been that Joseph was a widow from a previous marriage. A lot of the women were the ones who died most of the time first because of complications with birth. And so we just know so little, but we do know that that he gave it all, man. And he accepted the things that he didn't understand, and he looked out for the family, and obviously for the time that Jesus was growing up with him, he was the father and a father figure in the home, even though he realized, and you know, that's one of the questions that I used to always ask, well, not always, but I know that I brought it up more than once, when I was the master of ceremonies with Bishop Stevens, gave me a great opportunity to ask a lot of questions. And while we drove when I picked him up to go to a confirmation at a particular church, it gave me a lot of time with him to be able to ask all kinds of questions. And I asked, that was one of the questions I asked. I said, did Joseph truly, truly understand that what Mary must have told him and what he saw it? And you got to remember, you know, an angel does not appear to him like it appeared to Mary. He has visions in his dreams, and the visions are the ones that tell him to accept Mary for what Mary is telling you, but she's bringing the Lord and Savior into the world. And then he goes back to sleep again another time, and he says, you must leave Bethlehem because their King Herod is coming, planning to kill the baby. And so if I was Joseph, I wouldn't sleep at all, man. Every time I go to sleep, something crazy happens. And so he realizes and accepts the plan of God that a lot of times is ever changing. It is always something new heading in a different direction for a different purpose. And so it's one of the reasons why the church recognizes the holiness of Joseph, because he allowed the will of God to be fulfilled in everything that that God asked of him. So that's as much as we know about Joseph, even though that we wish that we had known him saying something, but we do know that when he could have had Mary stoned to death, because obviously they were enthroned one to the other, but in those days you lived together for a year, but you had no, you couldn't have any let me see how much. Thank you. Every word that kept coming into my head. So you couldn't have any intimate relations until a year after you have promised yourself to each other. And so all of a sudden, Mary is expecting. And so people would have said, you guys were supposed to wait, and you didn't wait. And then you had to face the people. And then Joseph had to face the reality that I kept my promise not to touch her. And so if I didn't touch her, who touched her? And so you got poor Joseph. And so he comes up with his plan was to leave her, abandon her, so that he wouldn't have to publicly denounce her and have her stoned to death. And so his love for her was so great that he was willing to make himself being the father who abandoned the wife so that the wife wouldn't be stoned to death. And so this, obviously, man, you start looking at all these steps in the life of Joseph, and you realize what a holy man he was. And so that night is when he has this revelation in a dream where everything that Mary had told him was revealed to him in the dream as well. So he accepts that. But when the question that I asked the bishop was, how did he truly know? And the bishop says, Tony, if he didn't know before, before the birthday, the nativity, he did then, that this was something that was from out of this world. It was not of any doing of this world. And so, you know, when you realize that the shepherds come to, because they were given the news and to come see the boy Jesus, and that they will find him in swaddling clothes, couldn't make this stuff up. And Joseph would have known scripture because he was a holy man, and that there was a relation, that it had to be him because he was related to King David, and it was going to, the Jesus or the Messiah was to come. It was prophesied that he would come from the line of King David. And so Joseph, essential part in this story as well. So for him to say yes was part of the entire story. So yeah, Joseph is in this year we have dedicated the year to Saint Joseph, and it's a great character, Rick, to take as a patron saint. To follow his example. Absolutely. Okay. So any other questions? No. Okay. Great. All right. So and please do ask these questions. They're great questions, man. And because everybody can learn from them. And there's a lot of things that a lot of time we skip over, that we should spend a little more time with. And if it's something that's in your heart, it may be there because somebody else needs to hear it. So please don't ever apologize for asking questions. In fact, I appreciate the questions more than the silence. And as we get into now, this week will be the last week of the liturgical year, and then we have the Feast of Christ the King the following Sunday, and then we begin Advent. And so we begin year C, where we read from the Gospel of Luke we get into Advent, and everything in Advent is a time of preparation for the coming of our Lord. And so we will spend a little more time with the characters in the nativity story, and we'll hear that a lot of that in the masses, and so they'll make a little more sense as we go along. Okay, now as far as today, the patron saint today is Saint Martin of Tours. Okay. Saint Martin of Tours was born in a pagan family. At the age of 10, he decided he wanted to join the Catholic Church. Okay, and he that's the decision he made. And little by little, he started learning a little bit more and more about it. And he grew up and became a soldier. Following the footsteps of his dad, and it's quite appropriate that on the day that we in America recognize the service of the soldiers, the church already had in place that on November 11th we would recognize the feast of Saint Martin of Tours, who's the patron saint of soldiers. And so he went off to war, and while he was between battles, he was taking the classes that we are taking here today, RCIA. He was also taking the RCIA classes. And he was in the process of becoming a member of the church and being baptized and confirmed into the church. And one day while riding his horse, he comes upon a beggar, and it says that it was a cold day or night, and the beggar was almost with nothing to wear. And he takes his cape and he cuts his cape in half and puts it over the beggar and then rides off so that the beggar will have something to wear. That night, in a dream, the beggar appears to him, and he hears the beggar says, look at the unbaptized Martin of Tours. He gave half his cape to the beggar who had nothing to wear. And he realized that that God was calling him to a greater commitment than being a soldier. And he basically renounces being a soldier and becomes a bishop. Eventually he becomes a Catholic member, and then he becomes a priest, and then he becomes a bishop in the Catholic Church. So, patron saint of soldiers, Crystal, Saint Martin of Tours. So both of you guys have got two saints today, Saint Joseph and Saint Martin of Tours. Awesome. All right. So today I just wanted to follow up on prayer. Okay. As we wrap up this section of prayer, I wanted just to make sure that we understand the purpose of why we pray. In the Tuesday night class, we have a family that grew up in Cuba under the communist regime, and they weren't allowed to go to church. In fact, it was frowned upon. So they grew up, and even to this day, they're just learning something totally new. So prayer to them is something new because they've never known to pray to anybody. And the sad thing is some years ago, I had a friend of mine who took his life and after going through some depression and lost his business. He was a professor at college, and I helped him try to get on his feet again. And I got him a job at a high school. And on the day, on his first day at school, he went out to the yard, and it was overwhelming to him. But the sad thing, and it's something that I'll share with you, because it's something that I pray for him at every mass. I pray for him because I stopped praying for him because I thought I had done everything I needed to do for him. I got him back on his feet. I got him a job. I had him set, and I stopped. And you know, when I think back of how much more I could have done for him and what I stopped doing, I stopped praying because I thought he was already set. We never stop praying. Never stop praying for anybody you're helping, because those prayers are what sustain them. Those are the prayers that give them the strength to overcome. And that's why I share the story with you. But with him, as with everybody else, always pray. Always pray. Never stop praying. Keep them in your prayers. And in fact, one of the things that I do, when I speak at parishes that I'm asked to come and do a talk on prayer, I always tell them, I says, keep a book at the coffee table in the living room, and that will be your prayer book. And every prayer that is asked of you, you write it in that book. You write it in that book, and you write each and every one and date it. And every day when you pray for everyone on that book. And that way, their prayers and their needs are constantly being prayed for, because sometimes we get so caught up with life that we forget the prayers that we were asked, or the prayers that we said, yes, I'll pray for you, absolutely. And then we get sidetracked and they're forgotten. And so if you get into the habit of getting a book, and in that book, you write your feelings and you put it in, you know, we have the custom of diaries, right? Where we write so much that, oh, you can't look at my diary. No. What we would like to do is one day when we're not around, if somebody goes through the prayer book, they will see how many people you are all. And so it's important for all of us, keep a prayer book. Keep a prayer book. And if somebody ever asks you and they come into your house and they see this prayer book on top of the coffee table in the living room, and they say, what is that? Oh, that's my prayer book. Every intention asked is written in that book. Since such and such a year, whatever. It's in there. And so every night when I pray for all the prayers in my book. That way I know that I haven't forgotten one. I prayed for all of them because they're on that book, okay? And it's what they do at in monasteries. They actually have a book where they write all these intentions and prayers. And when they do their prayers, they pray for the names and there are. In fact, we do it at church when we pray for the book that's on the altar. We've heard that, right? And what I do is I actually write a little more than just the name. I write the intention or the need on the prayer book, just so that one day if I'm not around and somebody is going through that and wondering how many people have been prayed for, that they know the story behind the name. Okay, so that's important. Now, this Monday, I got a call from my wife. That she had just received a call and asking me to pray for a gentleman that worked alongside of her. She was his clerk at the courthouse here downtown for 20 something years. And in fact, we had just been with him a few weeks ago. And now she gets a call that he was riding the bus to work on Monday, and he started having chest pains. And there was a nurse, happened to be a nurse on the bus, a training nurse. And she told the bus driver that he was having a heart attack, and the bus driver pulls over. They call 911, and it took about 30 minutes for the paramedics to get there. And the one thing that was unique about this was that another clerk that was also riding the bus with him says everyone got up from where they were at and started to pray over him out loud. And he says, this was in a world where everybody is getting canceled, when everybody just doesn't want to get involved in anybody's life, here's this young man on the floor having a heart attack, and everyone is standing on a pulled over bus saying what they can, praying and asking God for this young man. Long story short, by the time the paramedics showed up, he had recuperated enough that he actually walked off the bus and got into the ambulance. And he got to the hospital, and his wife was able to drive down from Fort Lauderdale she came to Jackson thinking that he was being taken to Jackson, then realized that he wasn't at Jackson, he was at another hospital. And so she gets to the hospital just before he goes into the operating room because they were going to put a catheter in for a blockage, and he passed away on the surgery. And it's amazing to me that I wonder how far those prayers at the bus went for him, that he felt the love, and he felt the love that may have carried him over to the other side. And this young man, and just to give you, and you know, I've too many stories for you guys today, but this young man was, I was doing the burial for his mother. I think it was 10 years ago? I think it was 10 years ago. I was doing the burial for his mother. And his father was, in fact, you know what? I should reach out. After we finish the class, I'm going to reach out to him. His father was a military man in the Army. And turns out that he's buried at the military cemetery in West Palm Beach. And that's what I was doing the burial. But we get to talk with him, with the father. And it turns out that the father had been deployed to Pearl Harbor a week after the attack of the Japanese. And he was sent over to Pearl Harbor on a search and rescue mission to gather up the bodies that they still hadn't found and to just clean up the place, basically. And I said, man, this is a godsend, because on that same day that you landed at Pearl Harbor, Corpus Christi celebrated their first mass. Would you bring, and I have a flag that flew over the Arizona that's still there at Pearl Harbor. Would you bring that flag as a memorial to those who died the week before we celebrated our first mass? And so he came, and the two sons, the son that just passed Monday, and the older son, brought him up and walked him up to the altar as he brought up the flag. And it's interesting because the last name is Rosario. And when I was doing the homily for Santa Maria at her funeral mass, I brought up the fact that Santa Maria's dad's name was Rosario. And so it brought the fact that 70 years later on the church that she and her father helped fund so that we could go to mass here at Corpus Christi, the gentleman who brings up the flag, his last name is Rosario, just like her dad, that had passed. So just interesting facts that bring it all together. But the point I was trying to make is the importance of prayer. If you do anything, and listen, a lot of times we do more with prayer than we do with preaching. And so prayer has to be what sustains you. And it's going to be what sustains your faithful life. If you think you can go through this journey and without connecting to prayer, and remember, mass is prayer, okay? You're gonna have a difficult time being able to stay connected, because that is what solidifies our faith. Prayer life, a prayer life, a prayer life. And please realize the importance of it. Couples, take the time before you fall asleep. Just say thank you, Lord, for my spouse, or thank you, Lord, for my wife, and take care of her. God bless. Good night. Boom. That's a prayer. That's a prayer. And that's a prayer that's a Thanksgiving prayer, because you're recognizing the blessing that you've had and finding someone who's decided to give you their lives for us to share it together. Okay, so get used to prayer. It'll get to a point where everything will come out of your mouth. We'll be praising God and recognizing how great He is and how wonderful He has been in our lives. And a lot of times that prayer life is what will unify us with the life that we hope to spend when the day comes that we fall asleep. Amen. Amen. All right. So that'll be it. And now to next week, please, there's a book in your house that's probably the one that most dust on it. It's called the Bible. Make sure you bring it to the to the class next week, and I'm going to go ahead and give you an introduction, and we're going to talk about the differences and why there are differences, and just give you an introduction. I'm not, this is not going to become a Bible class, but it will be an introduction enough for you to know how to navigate through the book and where to find what and where the Gospels and where the Psalms and where the letters. It'll be a wonderful evening that I hope to be able to cover as much as I can before Thanksgiving. Okay?
Deacon.
Before
we close, I just wanted to say once again, happy anniversary. And that the Lord may continue to bless you many, you and Myra, many, many more years together.
Thank you, guys. Thank you so much. And being around you guys makes it all worthwhile. Believe me, when you realize that the time away is given to a worthy cause, to people who are hoping to find as much joy as we have found in the Lord, it's all worthwhile. Thank you so much for throwing that in there. All right. The Lord be with you. May Almighty Spirit, Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you guys and have a wonderful evening. We'll see you next week.